And Jesus was going where...
And he did something unexpected. He reached out to a Samaritan woman, and then he had the opportunity to engage in meaningful conversation with her. So what we're going to look at tonight is his offering of the living water to this woman, where he offers her living water. And we really kind of picked up on this a little bit in the last week's message where Jesus talked about living water, and now we're picking up in the middle of the story here where she responds to that, when he begins to talk about living water and her response to that. So that's what we're going to look at tonight. This is verses 15 through 26. Let's pray before we look at this. Thank you, Father, that we can come together now to read your word. And I pray, Father, that you will help us to really meditate on the truths that are here. We pray, Lord, that as we end this Sunday, that this would encourage our souls and help us, Lord, to have good thoughts and meditations on our hearts as we head into the coming week. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. So what I'm going to do is read through this story and point out six things that are general ideas, general principles in this story that I hope will get you thinking a little bit more deeply about this story. The first is the desire for something that satisfies. The desire for something that satisfies. That's verse 15. Sir, the woman said to him, give me this water, because Jesus was talking about living water. Give me this water so I won't get thirsty and come here to draw water. So one thing that we see here is that the woman wants to get water so that she doesn't have to keep coming to the well. You can kind of see a misunderstanding there, right? She hasn't really caught on to what Jesus is really talking about. But she says, I want water that I can just have all the time and not have to come to this well. So what we see here, and this is so much how all of us are, I know how I am, we do have a desire to have our needs met, right? We have a desire. On one level, we understand we have needs. And I think what's interesting is she doesn't exactly get what he's saying. She might be a little incredulous because, you know, he's basically saying, I don't really need this well. And she's like, really, are you greater than our father Jacob? Well, can I have some of that water, right? I don't know exactly how she's thinking, but she would really like her life to be easier. Anybody here who wants their life to be easier? Yes. Anybody here who just wants God to do things in a way that is just nice and simple and pleasant? I want that, right? So that's where she's at. But in reality, Jesus is talking about something very important. He's saying that he has something that can satisfy because people have a thirst, right? And what is a thirst? It's a great picture for us. What is a thirst? A thirst is a strong desire. I believe that every person in this world has a thirst. It's within their heart. They're not even always completely aware of it, right? You're not thinking all the time, oh, I am in my heart, I am thirsty, but you are. And you can see because people want peace. They want security. They want love. They want purpose. And we don't even realize how much these things are driving us. They're thirst of our soul. They're thirst within our heart. And that's what Jesus is ultimately getting at. But what he has to do next, the second thing here, is to reveal her heart. He has to reveal her heart. So that's number two. Jesus says, go call your husband, he told her, and come back here. I don't have a husband, she answered. You have correctly said I don't have a husband, Jesus said, for you have had five husbands, and the man you now have is not your husband. What you have said is true. So did you notice what Jesus did? She said, when he said, I mean, it sounds like an innocent thing, right? Go call your husband. But in reality, Jesus knows what's happening here, right? Go call your husband, and she says, I don't have a husband. And so Jesus says to her, you're right. You don't have a husband. You've had five husbands. And you're living with someone who's not your husband. How do you think she felt about that? Here's what I love about Jesus. Jesus, when you read about him, he is always willing to say what needs to be said. And sometimes it's not what we like, but it's what we need. And a couple weeks ago, I got to spend time with a group of students, and one of them, there was one woman in our group, and she's a Korean woman. She's done ministry for 40 years and helped plant churches for 40 years with her husband. And she's actually a chaplain at Harvard University. She is a Korean woman who I have to say, if you spend any time with her, it doesn't take long before you realize she will tell you exactly what she thinks about something. And she is not scared to tell you exactly what she thinks. And so, you know, one of the churches I visited, this was just because I was curious, but I went to visit Rick Warren's church, Saddleback, because I was actually not that far. I don't know if you know anything about Rick Warren or Saddleback. I think he is actually affiliated with the Southern Baptist, and she's also she's affiliated with the Southern Baptist too. And I'll get to that in a second. But his church is huge, right? Huge church. I went on a Saturday night service. They had two services on Saturday. They had multiple services on Sunday. And so Rick Warren's a very well-known pastor. And that church has campuses that have started in other places. But she was talking about actually how she had known Rick Warren and had met him before. And if I met Rick Warren, I would probably ask him questions. I'd be really curious to discuss with him, and I'd probably ask questions. But when she met Rick Warren, she said, "You know what? I don't like how you're running your ministry." So she told me that she ministers to Harvard students. Harvard, you know, when you're talking about colleges, if you get to go to Harvard, that's like elite, right? But she said, "God has put me here because I'm able to talk to them in a way that," because sometimes they just think they're really up here. And she's very forward. And that kind of brings them down some notches. And she has led people to Jesus because she's able to be honest with them. That's a great trait. But Jesus is that way. And you know what I believe is that when Jesus is truthful, it can be offensive, right? But here's what I want you to think about. We as humans get offended, right? Have you ever been offended? I have. We all need to be offended about ourselves at certain points. We don't like it, but we all need to be offended in certain points. So Jesus is doing that. What he's doing, though, here is he's going right to the heart of the issue, and he's exposing something about her because our hearts, they get diverted. Jesus has brought this out many times. Now, for this woman, her diversion was in the area of relationships. But Jesus confronted people on all different things. He confronted people about money. Remember the rich young ruler? I'm doing really well. I'm following what God wants me to do. But when he asked Jesus how to have eternal life, what does Jesus say? Okay, you think you're doing really well? Well, go and sell everything you have. But the man loved his money. And Jesus was bringing that out. And so that man could not bear to let go of his money. Or how about the guy who said, yes, I know what I'm supposed to do. I'm supposed to love God and love my neighbor. And Jesus said, great. And the guy said, but who is my neighbor? Not really everybody, right? Jesus said, yes, even Samaritans, right? Relationships, though, that's where this woman is at. How many husbands did she have? She had had five husbands. She had relationship problems. I believe that this woman was thirsty in her soul, and when we have thirst in our souls, that longing can divert our hearts. And so what we do is we use things in the wrong way. Because of the thirst of our heart, what do we do with money? We use it in the wrong way. Because of the thirst of our heart, what do with people around us? We use them in the wrong way. And even in our relationships, romantic relationships or those intimate relationships, we can use it in the wrong way. So this woman had a problem, didn't she? She kept having husbands, and now she's living with a man, and Jesus brought it up. But here's the thing. Jesus was actually doing something that was hard to do at first. It seems bad, doesn't it? It seems bad when something is brought up that we don't like about us. But it's really for our good. I'm going to talk a little later about this more, but there's a guy I want to share about with you. A couple weeks ago, I went to a church, and the pastor of that church, his name is Brian Worth, he was actually sentenced to life in prison because he shot someone. And he is now the pastor of a church because God did a radical change in his life while he was in prison. I'll let him share his testimony on video a little later. But you know what? Life in prison for him was a bad thing, but it was a good thing. And this woman hearing from Jesus, "I know about you, I know about you," at first is like, "You're bringing up that?" But it was a good thing, because look at what happens. "Sir," the woman replied, you see some resistance here, right? At first there's resistance. "Sir, I see you are a prophet. Our fathers worshipped on this mountain, yet you Jews say that the place to worship is in Jerusalem." So this seems to be a little bit of a protective response, right? Oh, you're bringing up my past, and it's not comfortable. I have a theological question for you. You ever have that happen? You start to bring up things with people, and they have all these defense mechanisms and hard questions. However, some of these questions are really important. And Jesus actually does answer her question. And so the next point here is the persistence of Jesus. He said to her, "Believe me, woman, an hour is coming when you will worship the Father neither on this mountain." So this woman was talking about how the Samaritans had their own temple at one time where they worshiped. And the people in Jerusalem, the Israelites, the pure Israelites, had their temple in Jerusalem. And she's saying, okay, what's the right place to worship? And here, I love Jesus' words. "Believe me, woman, an hour is coming when you will worship the Father neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem. You Samaritans worship what you do not know. We worship what we do know, because salvation is from the Jews. But an hour is coming and is now here when the true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and truth. Yes, the Father wants such people to worship him. God is spirit, and those who worship him must worship in spirit and truth." Jesus is actually here using her theological question to invite her to true worship. He says, salvation, I like that. Actually, you Samaritans do have it wrong, just so you know. And salvation is coming through the Jews. They have God's word, and I am the one who brings salvation, is where he's going with this. But here's the thing. He's saying this is open to all. God is seeking worshipers, isn't he? God is seeking worshipers. So there is right, there is truth. There is right. Jesus is willing to point that out. There's truth. But the invitation is to know and worship God. And what's cool is you can come to God right where you are. You don't have to go to this place over here. You don't have to this place over there. Why? Because we don't need a physical temple anymore. We have the temple. We have Jesus. We have God with us. So where do we have to worship? No specific location. How far is it to God? All you have to do is come to Jesus. He's right there. And Jesus says God is seeking these people to worship him in spirit and in truth. So that's an invitation. Jesus is correcting her theology, but inviting her to worship God truly. And now you see some readiness in her. Look at this. Verses 25 and 26. The readiness of a person's heart here is seen. The woman said to him, "I know that Messiah is coming, who is called Christ. When he comes, he will explain everything to us." "I am he," Jesus told her, "the one speaking to you." I really believe at this point in the conversation, she's been really blown away by Jesus. And she says, "I know that when the King comes, when the Messiah comes," you can see now something ready within her. And I love this because I really believe God brings people to a place of readiness in his time. And this was the woman's time. And as soon as she was ready, Jesus said, "This is who I really am." See, she didn't know who he really was. She at one point, I see her a prophet. I mean, you know everything about me. "I'm the Christ. I'm the Messiah." And now we see how he changes her with the living water. This is the changing power of Jesus. Jesus, earlier in this same book, John the Baptist looks at Jesus, John the Baptist, ministry in the wilderness, preaching to people, and he looks at Jesus and he says, "Look, that's the Lamb of God who does what? Who takes away the sin of the world." See, this woman just wanted physical needs met. Jesus said, "You have a need in your soul. You have sin in your heart. And I've come to take that sin away and to give you new life." And that's why Jesus went to the cross. So that, as we sang earlier, our sin could be washed away by what he did for us. That shame that she felt about what she was doing in her life, Jesus said, "I'll take that on myself. What you feel shame about, what you feel guilty about, I take that on myself. I bring it to the cross on your behalf. And in place of that, my death, you can have life." And that changes people. That's the changing power of Jesus. That's how we have the living water that he talks about, that quenches our thirsty souls, because he gives us, through the cross and the resurrection, forgiveness of our sin. The Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. And so what happens to her when she starts to realize who Jesus is? Verse 39, if you skip down there, "Now many Samaritans from that town believed in Jesus because of what the woman said when she testified, 'He told me everything that I ever did.'" She went around and started telling people in her town, "You have got to hear about this man. He told me everything about myself." And so I believe we see here this woman was changed. And Jesus had talked to her about this water coming from within. She was experiencing within a new life. That's what happens. I'd like to read this quote. Many of you have heard this quote from an ancient theologian, Augustine. He said to God, "You have made us for yourself, O Lord, and our heart is restless until it finds its rest in you." That's the thirsty heart, right? And it's restless until it finds one thing. Remember, money, we'll misuse it. Relationships, we'll misuse them until our hearts find rest in God. And then, can we have money? Can we have relationships? Yes. But our heart has to be at rest in God. And this woman experiences this. And so I'd like now to share a testimony. Do you have the ability, Isaiah, to get that up? This is Pastor Brian Worth on a TV show giving his testimony. It's just a few minutes.
And it took a life sentence to break open that seed, to kind of germinate. And so I was in that one-man cell, Pastor Obed, with my face pressed against my knees, and I heard a noise in the hallway, and I looked up, I put my face against the bars, and I seen an elderly man, not a gang member, not a drug addict, but an elderly man coming down the hallway passing out Christian literature. And I was mad at the world. I didn't want to talk to nobody. But this man had the gospel pumping through his veins. And he came and he barged through my darkness. And so I got up and I thought I was going to drop the bomb on this guy. I said, Mister, I just got sentenced to life in prison. What are you going to do for me? And this man did not budge. Mm. He had the audacity to reach through the darkness of my bars, and he grabbed my hands and he said a prayer over me in the name of Jesus.
Wow.
And I believe right there that the compassion of God exploded in my one-man cell for this broken teenage gangbanger boy. And that long after that, Pastor Obed, I bowed my knee to God and I prayed. It wasn't even a prayer. I didn't even know how to pray. It was more of a sigh. It was a grunt.
Yeah.
But I called out to the God of my father. And God began to restore my life, Pastor Obed. This is one of the things that happened. God gave me a vision in the darkest moment of my life. He said, Brian, if you serve me and don't give up, eventually I will set you free from this life sentence to impact the world with the gospel. So I begin to prepare.
Yeah.
I begin to study the Bible and the Word of God, Pastor Obed, the Word of God.
Yeah, Tom.
It began to do for me what psychiatrists could not do. It began to do for me what counselor could
not
do.
Come on now.
It began to teach me how to love. And then I got filled with the Holy Spirit.
Yeah.
I started preaching,
I know you're
preaching
talking
the
right.
gospel.
Yeah.
And I just started seeing people respond.
Wow.
And thank God, you know, God began to restore my life. And after 16 years in prison, my wife and my father and my family, they began to pray for me. They began to go to the community and ask for help. And in 2008, after 16 years in prison, God had a sit-down meeting with then-Governor Arnold Schwarzenegger. And I don't know what he told him,
right.
but I believe he told him what he told Pharaoh 4,000 years ago.
I know.
Let my people
go.
Amen.
I know you're talking about, right, man of God.
After 16 years, Pastor Obed, they opened that door for me, and God fulfilled his promise.
My
he fulfilled his
God.
Word to a broken teenager, a broken down teenager. And that's why I'm excited, and I really believe that's why our church is seeing so many people respond to the gospel, because we're not special people. We're broken people with the anointing of God on us, and people are just surrendering to the Lord left and right.
And so, and man, now I understand why your church.
So I went to his church. It's called Chapel of Change. And one other person that had been there before said, if you go to that church, the people there look like people that in the past would have been very rough and probably scary to be around, right? But I can tell you, now you go in that church and those same people are the most loving people. And it's a joy to be around them. They have the love of God in their hearts. Their lives have been changed. They found the living water. How did that guy find the living water, though? It's interesting. The seed of the gospel had been planted early in his life, but when did it really come alive? He was in prison, and he was sentenced for life. Now, that was bad, but it brought him down to a low point, and he was ready to receive. He didn't even know. He was actually very angry. And he hears a guy coming down. I think when I heard it, by the way, he gave his testimony to us, and I heard him talk about all this live. And he told us it was an elderly white guy. So here was a guy who was very different than him. Very different than him. And when he was angry and yelling at the guy just reached through the bar and began to pray for him. So here's the point in all this. We've got to go where God leads us and do those unexpected things, like praying for the guy who has a life sentence in jail and showing the love of God to people, showing them who Jesus is. That's what we've got to do. And as we do that, the living water, this is the last point here, the living water is still at work today. This woman experienced that, and this is the same experience people are having today. So I hope that you will pray about this. May God use us in this amazing way. Let's pray. Thank you so much, Lord, for the living water that Jesus gives that satisfies the thirst of the soul. And I pray, Lord, that you will help us to take this living water to a world that is thirsty and so many people are desperately in need. Help us to be willing to go, Lord, to the places that are hard to go to and do the things that may be things that we wouldn't want to do on our own or think to do on our own, but you call us to them. And Lord, may that open up opportunities for us to share the truth and the love of Jesus. And I pray that through us, Lord, you will take the living water, Lord, that you've given to so many of us and help us to bring that to others so that their lives too can be changed. Thank you that this woman's life was changed, that we read about through Jesus, and what an encouragement to us to see that happen today. I pray all of this in Jesus' name. Amen.